Morning.
Members, good morning. We have a quorum, so I call to order today's meeting. Let me invite the administration to come in first. We're joined by three bureau chiefs and their respective teams. So let me first of all welcome Mr. Algernon Yao, Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development. Secretary for Innovation, Technology and Industry, Professor Sun Dong. Mr. Eric Zhang, Secretary for Constitutional and Mainland Affairs, and their colleagues. I will first invite the three secretaries to walk us through their papers. The discussion papers provided by the three bureaus are respectively CB bracket 21281/2024 bracket 01, 02, and 03. After the three secretaries have spoken, the floor will be open. Members, if you want to ask questions, please press the button now. So without further ado, I will pass the floor to Mr. Algernon Yao, Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development. But before he begins, I want to remind members that your questions should relate to the policy issues covered by the terms of reference of this panel, including commerce, industry, CNI services, innovation technology, protection of intellectual property, as well as promoting investments. Mr. Yao, Chairman, members, the third plenary session of the 20th Central Committee of the Communist Party mentions explicitly Hong Kong's strategic position as the three centers and one hub. Among these, the three centers refer to Hong Kong's role in leveraging the institutional advantages of one country, two systems to consolidate and enhance Hong Kong's status as an international financial, shipping and trade center. The chief executive also included a dedicated chapter on this theme in his 2024 policy address to explain his governing tenets. The development of the three centers is closely intertwined. Hong Kong has always been an international trade center, but with the rapid changes in global geopolitics and the continuous deepening of China's reform and opening up, Hong Kong's development in international trade also needs to actively seek and embrace changes. We must continue to strengthen our global trade network to help Hong Kong businesses and investors tap into markets, especially emerging markets. In this regard, Hong Kong plans to sign a free trade agreement with Peru this year, and is discussing investment agreements with Saudi Arabia, Bangladesh, Egypt, and Peru. In terms of multilateral trade, Hong Kong will continue to seek early accession to the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, or RCEP. Regarding cooperation with the mainland, the Ministry of Commerce and the Hong Kong SAR government signed a new agreement on the 9th of October to further amend the CEPA agreement on trade in services. Further liberalization measures in several areas in Hong Kong has a particular advantage will be introduced. They include allowing Hong Kong invested enterprises to adopt Hong Kong law and choose for arbitration to be seated in Hong Kong, as well as abolishing the requirement of Hong Kong service providers to engage in substantive business operations in Hong Kong for 3 years in most service sectors. These measures will help Hong Kong enterprises and professionals expand into the mainland market and attract more startups, foreign companies and talents to come to Hong Kong to enter the mainland market. The new agreement will come into effect on the 1st of March next year. In terms of investment promotion following Kenya, Kazakhstan and Egypt, the Consultant Office of Invest Hong Kong in Turkey is expected to begin operations in the first quarter of next year. The Overseas Promotion Network is very important for attracting investment. Invest Hong Kong has helped 852 domestic and foreign companies set up or expand their businesses in Hong Kong in the past year and 9 months, already exceeding the performance targets set in the 2022 policy address on a pro rata basis. In the first 9 months of this year, Invest Hong Kong has assisted 470 companies, surpassing the total of 382 companies for the entire year of 2023. And riding on this momentum, Invest Hong Kong will continue to attract mainland and overseas companies to invest in Hong Kong. The 9th Belt and Road Summit was successfully held on the 11th and 12th of September this year, attracting about 6,000 political and business representatives from the Belt and Road countries and regions. Next year, we plan to hold a Belt and Road Cross-Professional Forum. We'll also explore the feasibility of setting up a Belt and Road Capacity Building Center to connect with Belt and Road countries and regions through soft power. In terms of conferences and exhibitions, the incentive scheme for recurrent exhibitions launched last year has received a very positive response. The government will allocate an additional 500 million Hong Kong dollars to launch the ISRE 2.0. The scheme will focus on supporting new and regular large-scale international exhibitions to further promote the event economy and the overall benefit to our economy. At the same time, we will continue to promote the expansion of Asia World Expo and the redevelopment of Wan Chai North Project to provide more convention and exhibition facilities to promote the long-term development of our industry. While strengthening our network in trade, we also need to further consolidate and enhance our own strength and attractiveness. With the rapid changes in the global trade landscape, some supply chains are shifting towards the Global South and the Belt and Road countries, and mainland enterprises are actively going global. We will follow this trend and strive to build a high value-added supply chain service center. Invest Hong Kong will strengthen its engagement with mainland enterprises, especially small and medium-sized enterprises, by organizing investment promotion activities on the theme of cross-border supply chains to identify suitable companies interested in going global. Meanwhile, the Hong Kong Trade Development Council will provide professional advisory services for these companies. It will provide one-stop assistance to the enterprises for managing their regional businesses, as well as on-site support services to those enterprises looking to go global through TDC's overseas offices. With the wine duty removed in 2008, Hong Kong has become a regional wine trading and distribution hub, as well as one of the top three wine auction centers globally. Hong Kong market's demand for high-end liquor is also steadily growing. In light of the successful experience in 2008, balancing the considerations of promoting economic development, maintaining healthy public finances, and safeguarding public health, the government has announced an adjustment to the liquor duty rate to promote the liquor trade in Hong Kong and give impetus to the development of high value-added industries such as logistics storage, tourism, as well as high-end food and beverage consumption. We will also enhance the external trade momentum of local enterprises. The government will relaunch the principal moratorium arrangement under the SME Financing Guarantee Scheme to give small and medium-sized enterprises more room to seize the opportunities brought about by the economic recovery. The Hong Kong Export Credit Insurance Corporation will increase the maximum indemnity ratio from 90 to 95%, providing greater protection to exporters in carrying out transactions. The HKECIC will also increase the number of free buyer credit checks for exporters and expand the service coverage from ASEAN to the mainland and the Middle East. The government will continue to introduce measures to help SMEs expand their cross-border e-commerce businesses. We will inject 1 billion Hong Kong dollars into the BUD Fund to help small and medium-sized enterprises upgrade, transform, and expand into new markets. We will expand the geographical coverage of the e-commerce EC scheme to the 10 ASEAN countries. The CDB and the Hong Kong TDC will enhance the provision of information to SMEs on e-commerce in the mainland and ASEAN markets. We'll continue to hold the Hong Kong Shopping Festival over the next 2 years to help SMEs expand their e-commerce sales markets in the mainland. To complement the expansion of e-commerce easy, we'll also hold the Hong Kong Shopping Festival in the ASEAN market at an appropriate juncture. Chairman, apart from consolidating and enhancing the three centers, developing new quality productive forces is another key issue in the policy address. The core element of new quality productive forces is to achieve high quality economic development through technological empowerment. Hong Kong's continuous development as an international trade center also requires upgrading and transformation, such as cross-border e-commerce business and the construction of a high value-added supply chain service center, which are manifestations of new quality productive forces in international trade. Technological innovation will be an important driving force for the industries. As an international R&T center, Hong Kong also needs a comprehensive intellectual property regime to protect R&D innovation and creativity. The government will propose enhancing the copyright ordinance regarding the protection for AI technology development next year. The government is also reviewing the current registered designs regime. A consultation will be launched next year, and the legislative amendment proposals will be submitted to streamline the IP litigation processes for the High Court to manage and hear these cases more effectively. The Trademarks Registry under the Intellectual Property Department will launch a new AI-assisted image search service next year to facilitate public searches of the trademark database. With the support of the central government, Hong Kong plans to participate in the World Intellectual Property Organization Lex Judgment Database next year, sharing important IP case precedents of local courts to showcase the quality of our IP-related judgments. In terms of strengthening IP talent training, the Intellectual Property Department will cooperate with the Qualifications Framework Secretariat to develop practical teaching materials for training institutions benefiting employees in 23 different industries. Chairman, with these remarks, I'll be happy to take questions from members. Thank you, Mr. Yao. I will now invite Mr. Professor Sun to speak. Chairman, members, good morning. I'm delighted to attend today's policy briefing for the CIIT panel. Innovation technology provides key impetus for Hong Kong's high-quality economic development. To further promote the development of R&T in Hong Kong and develop new quality productive forces, the 2024 policy address has announced a series of measures to advance Hong Kong's R&T development. I will briefly introduce them in the following. On enhancing the R&T ecosystem and promote new industrialization in Hong Kong and to enlarge the R&T talent pool to create strong impetus for growth, we will enhance new industrialization development and institutional setup, formulating a medium to long-term development plan for new industrialization in Hong Kong and facilitate the establishment of Hong Kong New Industrialization Development Alliance. It will foster closer collaboration among the government, industry, academia, R&D, and investment sectors by building a cooperation platform for new industries in Hong Kong. On increasing investment for the R&T industries, the highlight measure this year is the $100 billion R&T Industry-Oriented Fund. A fund of funds will be set up to guide social capital investment in designated strategic emerging and future industries. These include life and health technologies, artificial intelligence and robotics, semiconductors and smart devices, advanced materials and new energy. We'll also allocate $1.5 billion to optimize the R&T Venture Fund. Matching funds will be set up jointly with the market to invest in startups of strategic industries. We'll also launch the pilot R&T Accelerator Scheme and allocate $180 million in matching grants to attract domestic and overseas professional startup service providers to establish accelerator bases in Hong Kong. To drive research and development, we're actively preparing to build the third Inno Hong Kong Research Cluster with a focus on advanced manufacturing, materials, energy, and sustainable development. will also establish a research center under the Inno Hong Kong Research Cluster to promote aerospace technology R&D and participate in the Chang'e 8 mission, thereby contributing to the nation's aerospace development. Regarding new INT land, the first three buildings of the Hong Kong Shenzhen Innovation and Technology Park at the Lok Ma Chau Loop will be completed by the end of the year, with the remaining five buildings to be completed over the next 5 years. We'll also strive to release approximately 20 hectares of new INT land in the Hong Kong Science Park starting from 2026-27 to be developed and operated by the Hong Kong Science and Technology Parks Corporation. For Sandy Ridge in the North District, we will initiate rezoning this year and expand the INT land for data centers and related industries from 2 hectares to 10 hectares. In terms of proactively integrating into the overall development of the country and consolidate our role as a bridge connecting the mainland and the world, the Steering Committee on the Hong Kong Shenzhen INT Park in the Loop, chaired by the Chief Executive, has been established to provide top-level and macro directions on the overall strategy, planning and layout for the development of Hong Kong Park and Steer, and coordinate the work of relevant policy bureaus and departments in the development. The development outline for the Hong Kong Park of the Hetao Shenzhen Hong Kong Science and Technology Innovation Cooperation Zone will be promulgated this year. There will be innovative policies to facilitate the flow of personnel, materials, capital and data between Hong Kong and Shenzhen Parks. This will transform the zone into a key source of new quality productive forces for our country. We are currently discussing these innovative facilitation measures with the relevant national ministries and commissions. We will report on the latest development of Hong Kong Park to the panel in due course. We will push forward the implementation of various measures, continue to strengthen Hong Kong's position as an international INT center, drive the transformation and upgrading of traditional industries, and actively cultivate emerging industries. That concludes my briefing. I welcome questions from members. Thank you.
謝謝孫東局長.
Thank you, Professor Sun. Next official, Mr. Eric Zhang, Secretary for Constitution and Mainland Affairs. We've just heard from the Chief Executive's third policy address in his term. Today, I'm going to brief members on the relevant policy initiatives of the CMAB. The Chief Executive highlighted that we will deepen reform and develop new growth points. We have the advantage of one country, two systems, and we will also leverage the spirit of the third plenary session. We will seize upon the chances in order to make greater contributions to the country. And we will also inject impetus into our further development locally. The steering group on integration into national development was set up. It led the administration in different sectors of society to make greater contributions to the country by tying in with different national strategies. The steering group will continue to monitor initiatives on integration into the overall national development from a high-level perspective in order to promote the high-quality development of Hong Kong. The GBA, the development of the GBA is a key national strategy personally devised, planned, and driven by President Xi Jinping. The resolution of the Central Committee of the Communist Party of China on further deepening reform comprehensively to advance Chinese modernization said that we have to deepen cooperation within the GBA through better harmonization of rules and mechanisms and enabling the GBA to better play its role as engine of high-quality development. With the staunch support of the country, we have seen a lot of good results. There is more convenient flow of talents within GBA and Hong Kong. The industrial structure has seen an enhancement. We have also seen improvement in the development of new quality productive forces. talents are key to developing the International I&T Center of the GBA. The Steering Group on Integration into National Development will continue to proceed with the strategies to promote the development of the GBA. We will adopt a multi-pronged approach, and we will also cement our advantage of the principle of one country, two systems. We are the only place that is a metropolitan city having the advantage of our motherland as well as the international arena. We will continue to enhance our competitive edge in different areas, and we will also better assume our role as the super connector and super value adder. So we will continue to give full play to our key role as a two-way platform for going global and attracting foreign investment. We'll continue to maintain close liaison with Macau and different places to better leverage the Guangdong-Hong Kong mechanism. The purpose is to implement co-location arrangements and realize our strategic mission. We will also create a better business environment for the GBA. We will expedite the development of Qianhai, of Nansha, and Hengqing. The purpose is to develop new growth point for the GBA. Hong Kong will also work with other cities in mainland China, including Beijing, Pearl River Delta, Yangtze River. In addition, we'll continue to tell the good stories of the GBA. We will step up publicity to the mainland as well as the international community. On the one hand, we need to attract overseas capital, talents, technologies to come to Hong Kong. On the other hand, we will also encourage mainland businesses and talents to make good use of the distinctive advantages of Hong Kong to develop the local market. Last year, the chief executive met with the mayor of Beijing and the mayor of Shanghai. There were bilateral cooperation conferences held with different mayors. The chief executive also met with the secretary of the CPC Guangxi Zhuang Autonomous Region Committee and the secretary of the CPC Shaanxi Provincial Committee. We have signed some cooperation agreements. There are 5 offices and 11 liaison units of the Hong Kong SAR government in the mainland. They will continue to strengthen the connection and communication with the mainland authorities. We will accept media interviews, take part in different events, commercial conferences, online and offline publicity events to promote the good stories of Hong Kong and our distinctive advantages of one country, two systems. This is my introduction. My team and I are happy to take questions from the floor. Thank you, 3 secretaries. The coverage is quite wide today. I now open the floor to questions. There are quite some members today, so each member is given 4 minutes, questions and answers included. Please be succinct. And please try your best to finish your questions in 2 minutes in order to allow sufficient time for the administration to reply to you. Members who have pressed a button, Mr. Dominic Lee, Mr. Robert Lee, Mr. Sunny Tang, Jimmy Ng, Martin Liao, Professor William Wong, Mr. Ambrose Lam, Peter Shil, Shang Hai Long, Dr. Wendy Hong, Mr. Dennis Lang, and Mr. Duncan Chu. Mr. Dominic Lee. Thank you, Chairman. Hong Kong has been the trade center and in relation to tax concession measures, they are key to attracting overseas enterprises to come to Hong Kong. They are great incentives. I'm glad to see the policy address accepting our proposal, reducing the liquor duty from 100% to 10%. This will help Hong Kong to cement its status as the international liquor trading center. We fully support this measure. Back then, after the wine duty rate was adjusted, Hong Kong became one of the important wine auction centers around the world. On promoting liquor trade, will you draw reference from the cancellation of the wine duty rate in 2018? Will you look into different policies? Will you also take proactive measures to attract international liquor auctions in order to attract more buyers to Hong Kong? Will you also consider having a dedicated liquor warehouse in order to enhance the logistic arrangements? Will you also hold more exhibitions, wine tasting fairs, in order to enhance the exposure of Hong Kong as an international liquor trading center? Secretary Mr. Algernon Yao, thank you, member, for your question. I also thank member for your support for the reduction of duty rate of liquor duty rate. We draw on our experience with the cancellation of wine duty rate in 2018. Based on our experience, we became the third largest international wine trading center. There wasn't a great increase in amount, but the value went up by 375%. With this in mind, we want to develop Hong Kong into an international liquor trading hub, thereby facilitating the development of different industries, including warehouses, storage, logistics, upscale F&B, and so on. We will also disseminate information to different sectors of the community. Chambers of Commerce expressed interest in our policies, and they are also confident about it. There are different exhibitions, say Wine and Dine Festival. All these events will promote the F&B industry as well as the liquor industry. The industry welcomed this measure because we can promote the trading of liquor in Hong Kong, including the liquor manufactured by our motherland. This will help Hong Kong become the international liquor trading hub. This is just a start. There's still a lot of work that we have to do. It's important to seek suitable places as storage places for liquor, where we identified room for giving assistance, we will render assistance to enterprises. We will also step up publicity about promoting Hong Kong as an international liquor trading hub. Thank you, Chairman. Next member, Mr. Robert Lee. Thank you, Chairman. One of the important roles of Hong Kong is to attract global investors to have a better understanding of the high quality enterprises in mainland China. Xi'an and a couple of different cities have signed MOU with Hong Kong X. There are a total of 20 odd high quality corporations and internationally renowned brands. From the information papers on the CMAB, we have seen some indicators. For example, in the policy address on the work promoting the GBA, we have seen 10,000 attendances as well as 1,200 entrepreneurs attending different conferences. There were also visits to different mainland authorities or bodies, no less than 3,380 speaking occasions, no less than 440 media interviews or briefings, no less than 850 business and trade meetings. These are the figures provided by the CMAB. The information paper also mentioned cooperation agreements. Can you explain to us how you will enhance the efficiency of these events when it comes to attracting investors? How can we leverage these events to enhance the success rate? There are many such events. But how can we provide better arrangements to help these enterprises identify investors? Thank you.
Secretary Mr. Yao. Thank member for the question. In terms of attracting inward investment, a lot of efforts have been made. We also have 16 offices under the CMAB. In recently, the financial secretary promoted Hong Kong in the cities in the Eastern China region. Measures are put in place to help corporations in the region of our country to go global. As set out in the policy address, this is one of the missions for us to develop a high value-added supply chain service center. Apart from that, in different provinces and cities, our government has offices to provide information to enterprises. In the Greater Bay Area, we have the GoGBA platform. There are offices in the 9 cities in the Greater Bay Area for enterprises to tap markets. We can leverage Hong Kong as a platform to help enterprises go global. Let me invite the Commissioner for Head of Invest Hong Kong to say a few words on this issue. As mentioned, we work with the CMAB and other bureaus, and we have held large-scale meetings such as the Beijing-Hong Kong cooperation meetings. Now, we have meetings at different levels. Some of the briefing sessions will help enterprises learn better about Hong Kong as a platform for them to go global. At the same time, Invest Hong Kong also hold medium-sized and activities of a smaller scale to help enterprises understand Hong Kong's advantages. On the multinational high value at the supply chain service center, we held altogether 9 such meetings on a smaller scale in different places in the mainland. Some private as well as state-owned enterprises have contacted our office to seek help with going global. We'll continue to ramp up our efforts in the coming months. Next, Mr. Sunny Tan. Thank you, Chairman. On behalf of the BPA, I thank the government for taking on board a lot of suggestions on different policy areas. Now, I'd like to talk about traditional industries such as the textile and garment sector that I represent. We have the Bud Fund. We also have e-commerce Easy, which will be expanded to cover the 10 ASEAN markets, as well as the Hong Kong ECIC new initiative, new industrialization development alliance, which will be helping emerging as well as traditional industries to set up production lines in Hong Kong. I think all these ideas are good. The next step is to help in all industries find their footing in Hong Kong, and I need to declare that I'm chair of the Productivity Council. I really appreciate the government's latest measures. My next question is how we further strengthen our efforts on the development of industries as well as the supply chain, because it's all about enhancing the competitiveness in Hong Kong, and that covers a number of aspects. For example, for enterprises to go global, as well as supply chain management, setting up production lines in Hong Kong. As far as our policies and our efforts in dovetailing with the national strategies are concerned, how do we make sure that we are in full grasp of the situation so as to maximize our potential and enhance our competitive edge? Because for different industries, in order to set up the manufacturing base, there are different considerations. So we need to be more proactive instead of just be a service provider, especially when we are to integrate into the national development. Are we reaching out to the relevant authorities in the mainland? Is there any liaison between the Hong Kong SL government and local governments, as well as B2B connections? Professor Sun Dong. Well, instead of, in terms of developing the I&E ecosystem in Hong Kong, we need to have vision, and we need to take things at a higher level and consider things from a national perspective. In other words, Hong Kong is a two-way platform for attracting investment and going global. You just referred to supply chains. Now, this is a very important aspect. The CDB has been making a lot of efforts in this regard, and we also need to do more, be it in industrial chains, talent, technology, important raw materials, high-end technology, so on and so forth. These are the core elements to make Hong Kong a very important hub, and this is the role that Hong Kong plays. We are building various platforms. For example, in this year's policy address, we are going to build the Santin Technopole, which is industry oriented. Now, enterprises from the mainland will go global via this platform at Santin Technopole. They are going to set up the bases there. Likewise, for the Hong Kong Park in the Loop, we also have similar measures. We are setting up the Hong Kong industry-oriented fund so as to attract foreign capital to invest in our industries. We have startups. We also have high-end tech firms. We need to build we also need to attract service providers to set up accelerator base in Hong Kong. So like you said, we are going to develop Hong Kong into a new industrialization base. So we need to work on supply chains as well. Next, Mr. Jimmy Ng. Thank you, Chairman. First of all, I thank the Chief Executive for adjusting the liquor duty in the policy address. Now, BPA was the first political party that came up with that idea. I think it's a very good idea to lower the liquor rate, so liquor duty, so as to make Hong Kong a trading hub. We have ETOs and mainland offices. There are so many of them. But do we have a strategy so as to attract external businesses to come and take part in the activities I mentioned in Hong Kong? Next, in order to build a trading hub in Hong Kong, I think apart from publicity, we need to work on some specific issues. say, for liquor auction, we're talking about large sums of money, several hundred million dollars at a time. So we need to develop finances in this regard. We also need good insurance for the storage of liquor. So you need to reach out to major insurers in this regard. The insurance premiums could be very costly. So I'd like to have the secretary's take on my suggestions. Do you have any plans, Mr. Yao? Thank you, Mr. Ng, for the questions. As announced in the policy address, the liquor duty has just been slashed, and this has caused quite a lot of discussions, and the CEDB has received inquiries. In 2024-25, the ETOs will be focusing on promotion publicity. Now, in a few months' time, they will make a report to LegCo about the progress of work of ETOs. In fact, after the delivery of the policy address, the ETOs have participated in a meeting, and we have briefed them about the latest policy measures in the policy address. So I believe that the ETOs will be given a mission to publicize the lower liquor duty rates. Now, one of the core functions of ETOs is to promote trade for Hong Kong. Now, taking the riding on the experience of building a wine auction and trading center, I believe that we are going to see something similar for liquor. As to whether we should develop liquor finances as well, I think we are going to have some insight after the rollout of the new policy. In respect of different industries, we are going to roll out new measures, and we will closely monitor the developments. I'll see if Permanent Secretary has anything to add. Thank you, Secretary. The member mentioned a number of points. As said by the Secretary, we have fully explained this very important initiative in this year's policy address to the heads of ETOs. For some countries with more activities relating to liquor, I know that they will ramp up publicity in this regard. The Secretary mentioned promotion publicity, and let me also chip in. In this year's policy address, there are initiatives that will bring benefits to economic development in Hong Kong, and not only the lower liquor duty rate. I'd like to leverage the ETOs in Hong Kong to publicize our new initiatives to the world. I think this is a common refrain. In order to be successful, we need not only the initiatives, but also good publicity strategies. Foreign media don't tend to help us in this regard. So we need the ETOs in different places to promote our strengths in the policy address. Next, Mr. Martin Liao. Thank you, Chairman. According to statistics, the government has adopted over 100 G19's suggestions, especially on economic development. So this policy address is one built on collective wisdom after extensive consultation. The G19 welcomes the policy address. I have 2 points. First, there are numerous measures to build Hong Kong into an international I&T center, including the $10 billion industry INT industry-oriented fund to foster closer collaboration among the government, industry, academia, R&D, and investment sectors. It is believed that the measure could help attract social capital to invest in INT sector. In fact, we need patient capital to bolster the development of INT sector. In fact, according to the national report, it's all about making investment in high-tech projects at an early stage. Another fund was set up that targets the early stage of R&D all the way to proof of concept trials. This is a crucial stage before moving on to commercialization of R&D results. Likewise, we need to unleash the potential of patient capital. Now, my question is whether there are strategies to attract investors to participate in the investment of INT research projects at different stages so as to help form the core of patient capital in Hong Kong. Second, in order to build Hong Kong into an IP trading hub, we need professional talents. Talent is crucial to the development of this hub. According to the government, in 2025, a survey will be conducted in relation to professional services for the IP sector for facilitating manpower planning in the future. In terms of IP valuation, management, insurance, and other professional services, will the government focus on talents with multiple skills, focusing on IP management and valuation?
Professor Sun, please. Thank you, Chairman. The policy address proposed the INT Industry-Oriented Fund. Fund of funds will be set up. And then there are five main clusters to promote the development of INT. This is very different from investments in the past. On the one hand, we need to tie in with the development of the industries in Hong Kong, and we target important sectors from the perspective of Hong Kong and our country. We also need to leverage the positive relationship between the market and the administration . And the government has to coordinate the development. Well, the time was 8 years, but right now that is 6 plus 6 years. In other words, 10 years, 12 years from now on, there will be new capital, and we will adopt a mode that is accepted by the market as well. As the limited partner of the sub-funds, the administration will select professional fund managers to be general partner of sub-funds. This tells us clearly that the role of the government is to combine the capable government and efficient market. So the capital will go towards the development of INT in Hong Kong. Investment is key. We need it to develop Hong Kong. Mr. Algernon Yao, regarding IP, as in the regional IP center, under the A center's positioning, we have a lot of work to do on qualifications, framework, legislation, we have a lot to do to promote Hong Kong as a regional INT center. Now I invite the Director of Intellectual Property, Mr. David Wong, to give you more information. Thank you, Secretary. First of all, on research, it's the second time we conduct this research. We have users, we also have legal talents, professionals, consultants, evaluation, all these are very important as well. We want to have a better grasp on the grooming of talents on these fronts so that the administration will have sufficient knowledge as to how we can better develop the IP industry in Hong Kong. Talents are key when it comes to the INT sector. We need talents with background in technology, but we also require talents with expertise in patent. So we are already working on the qualifications of local patent agents. We need to know the needs of Hong Kong so that we can groom talents to promote professional trade in this area. The IPD also promotes the original grand patent system. Patent examiners are experts in this regard. They have relevant background experience and they are also experts in patent law. We have some 30 patent examiners in Hong Kong. We hope to enlarge the pool so that we can groom more talents to facilitate the flow between the private and the public markets. We have done a lot of training work. We want to train 5,000 IP practitioners to take these courses. We have trained over 3,000 such personnel, so we're going to focus on the grooming of talents in the future. Thank you, David. Professor William Wong, thank you, Chairman. I have four questions. One, we're short of INT development land. We also need to enhance our cooperation and interaction with other cities in GBA. Science Park in Futian already has a Hong Kong park. We also have HSITP in the loop. The first phase will be commissioned soon. They are managed by two different companies. I want to ask the administration, how will the division of work be between these two parks? With the commissioning of the HSITP, there will be more cooperation and development on the INT sector. There will also be interaction between Hong Kong and the mainland. How many talents do we have? I mean talents who have knowledge about the relevant expertise. Will the government groom talents in this area? That is, those who are well up in tech transfer. According to the policy address, we strive to commence service in 2025 when it comes to regional IP center. But it was also mentioned by 2030 there would be autonomous IP examination. So when the center comes on stream in 2025, will we have sufficient manpower and personnel to accomplish the relevant mission? The 14th five-year plan of the country has already set down the role of Hong Kong in the overall direction. It supports Hong Kong in cementing the four traditional sectors as well as the A centers. Our country is already preparing for the 15th five-year plan. How will Hong Kong play a part? Professor Sun, followed by Mr. Algernon Yao. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Professor Wong, for your questions. At present, the Hong Kong Park of the Loop is managed and operated by HSITP. It's about 17 hectares. By the end of this year, we will announce the development plan. We have a building in the Loop area. We want to have an access point in the HSITP. The Hong Kong Park is run by the HSITP Corporation Limited. Regarding your second question, with the commissioning of the HSITP, there will be a lot of technology transfers. Yes, that is correct. In future, based on our development plan, we encourage the commercialization of R&D results as well as technology transfers. There will also be an internationally competitive R&D transformation and pilot production base for industries. We will attract world-leading enterprises to come to Hong Kong. In the policy address and the budget last year, the IPD had as many as 2,600 professionals. Regarding policy address this year, we mentioned accelerator schemes. And we are working on the 1+1 scheme. We want to commercialize the relevant INT results and cultures. Regarding IP, I'd like to ask Mr. David Wong to supplement. In 2025, the earliest, we want to set up a center under the WIPO WIPO. That is the WIPO Technology and Innovation Support Center. Over 100 bodies are working with WIPO. We want to recruit talents who are well up in IP, and they can provide services in relation to technology and innovation support. We not only recruit talents in Hong Kong, but also those from the international community. We want to carry out substantive examination of IP. We also want them to recruit and train patent examiners. From electricity, machinery, we will provide training to these talents, and it is hoped by 2030 in Hong Kong, we will be able to carry on with autonomy in patent examination. Regarding 15th five-year plan, Mr. Algernon Yao, please. Professor William Wong mentioned the 15th five-year plan. We are actively implementing the 14th five-year plan announced by the country. We are working very hard to tie in with the strategies under the 14th five-year plan. We also need to give full play to our positioning of the A centers. We will actively liaise with the country, the relevant counterparts, to set down the future development direction. Next, Mr. Ambrose Lam, please.
Thank you, Chairman. The policy address refers to measures to promote low-altitude economy. as one of the development directions. Now, we understand that it takes time to develop a new industry, and it's very it's not realistic to expect short-term results. However, we hope that with the input via government measures, there will be some achievement. Low-altitude economy has become the major economic driver for many cities in the mainland. In Shenzhen, in 2023, the value of this economic development amounted to 290 billion yuan. What is the government's assessment on possible GDP contribution by the low-altitude economy and in percentage terms? Now, in order to take it forward, we need to review the current legislation, which will be followed by legislative amendments or new proposals. Does the government have any KPIs on when these are to be completed? How long does the government expect it to take in order to address all the obstacles? Now, I think the problem lies with the lack of publicity despite all the good work done by the government. In fact, recently, I've heard this. On legislative enactments, because of the bills passed by the Legislative Council, 2047 is no longer the deadline for Hong Kong, so to speak, because we have the extension of government leases, ordinance coming into effect. But because of a lack of publicity, there are still rumors that the value of our properties will be drastically reduced because of the land lease issues. So I think the government should step up publicity. Now I will invite Professor Sun Dong to respond to low altitude economy. Yes, in the policy address, the chief executive announced that a dedicated team will be set up, led by the Deputy Financial Secretary, to oversee this. The Secretary for Transport and Logistics will also be deputy to the DFS in order to take forward legislative matters and other issues. There will also be participation by different policy bureaus, including the IDI Bureau. But in fact, I think that the other bureau will be in a better position to answer this question. But let me say this. Low-altitude economy is a concept put forward by our country. This is an area of growth with a lot of potential. Indeed, in our country, there are use cases and there are technologies available. So we see potential. In Hong Kong, this is a rather new concept. We need to overcome a lot of hurdles, including legislative amendments. The SAR government, however, is sparing no efforts in exploring how we could develop this new growth point called low-altitude economy. Now, there are two parks in the loop, and we've put forward the proposal to facilitate the flow of materials across two parks because we want to have a smooth logistics arrangements for the two parks in Hetao. Using unmanned aerial system or drones would be a very convenient means of transport because for the transport of a movement of materials and goods, they can make use of the low altitude airspace that is below 1,000 meters. So this is one of the early use cases of low altitude economy in Hong Kong. I think there's been a lot of hot air about low altitude economy, but in order to make it happen, the government should put in place proper arrangements. We've heard about some recent problems relating to smuggling, publicity, national security, and these are issues to be ironed out, especially cross-boundary smuggling. So that means the Customs and Excise Department in Hong Kong must do its gatekeeping job. So I'd like to invite Mr. Yao and Professor Sun to respond to the point I raised as well. Now, there are concerns from the community in relation to telecommunications or the control of drones. Now, say in the mainland, there are 1 million controllers available. But in Hong Kong, we don't have the necessary talents. What if something goes wrong? It could be a major safety issue. So would the two secretaries respond to this point? Let me respond to your point. I fully agree with your viewpoint, and that is why we need to develop use cases in terms of cross-boundary movement of materials. We believe that this could happen at the loop because we have the regulations and the framework ready. The other point is we need to upgrade our infrastructure. Mr. Yao, cross-boundary movement, low-altitude economy is a new highlight in the policy address. In the mainland, development has taken place for a long time in terms of not only the technology but also talent. Now, under the leadership of the Deputy Financial Secretary, we have participation by different policy bureaus in this dedicated team. We will look at the legal framework, the use of low-altitude space. And I think at this stage, these issues will be reflected at the meetings for us to consider how we should take forward low-altitude economic development. We'll also be making reference to the development model in the mainland. Anything to add, Mr. Zhang? No? Mr. Yao, I'd like to ask another question on publicity. As I mentioned, publicity is crucial. We need to paint a positive picture in particular. So, how should we leverage the ETOs and the TDC? Now, we have a set of publicity strategies. Right after the delivery of the policy address, we held a briefing session with the Hong Kong ETOs to address inquiries. Now, we also would like to hammer home this message to the Hong Kong ETOs that it is very important for them to step up publicity. We have different meetings, activities to showcase Hong Kong strengths such as Smart Hong Kong. And in fact, the mainland offices have reached out to different enterprises in the mainland. This is a must for CEDB in telling good stories of Hong Kong. Next, Mr. Peter Shou. Thank you. I support this policy address, especially on developing Hong Kong as an international trade center. We need to tap the markets along the Belt and Road as well as in ASEAN. Now, for Belt and Road countries and the Middle East, as I understand, 90% of the population are Muslims. They need to observe very strict rules. For example, for food, they make sure that only halal food is consumed. They don't prefer anything with pork as an ingredient. So we need to develop Muslim-friendly policies in Hong Kong as well. My question is whether the government has made an effort in this regard. Next, on developing the regional IP trading center in Hong Kong is very important as we take forward INT development, as we develop new quality productive forces, and as technology is developing very rapidly on the internet, we need to protect IP rights. Apart from offering protection to IP owners, what can we do to help normal traders? Because I've heard from my trade this complaint. They've imported goods from elsewhere, and then if the IP has been registered in another jurisdiction in the importing country, for example, then there'd be the end of the matter. But then for some merchandises that they have purchased, the problem is they face lawsuits of infringement. And sometimes the case will be taken to the High Court. In some instances, the merchandise is subject to IP protection, already registered, only that no trading activity is involved. The whole purpose is to conduct patent trolling and to go after normal businesses. The third point is this. About liquor duty, I believe the lower rates would definitely help high-end liquor market. But in fact, 85% of alcohol in Hong Kong do not benefit from the lower liquor rate. So will you consider lowering the liquor duty for those priced at $200 or below so that the average Joe will benefit from the policy as they consume liquor? Mr. Yao, thank you for the questions about Muslim-friendly policies. The chief executive led the delegation to visit Saudi Arabia and the UAE. Quite some MOUs have been signed. We've had a very successful trip, and we've been able to attract investors from these places. And indeed, the Muslim culture is quite distinct. And as mentioned in the policy address, and as mentioned by the chief executive in media interviews, he's talked about the Islamic culture or the Muslim culture. In fact, we have been in touch with the relevant organizations. I've also asked the hotel associations to be mindful of the facilities to be provided to Muslim visitors. For example, there should be a prayer room, and there should be signs in the rooms to help them with their praying routine. Likewise, for the catering sector, they also see potential in tapping business opportunities in this regard, and will continue to work with the Hong Kong TDC, the Hong Kong Tourism Board, the hotel associations, as well as the sector to discuss and explore further such opportunities so that Hong Kong becomes an ideal place of travel for Muslim visitors. Mr. David Wong can take this question on IP. Yes, Director of Intellectual Property. Thank you. To answer the member's question, we need to balance the protection for IP owners against the needs of users. The IP regime in Hong Kong is recognized by the world. For example, According to the 2024 competitive report released by the IMD in Switzerland, we ranked the 8th in terms of IP protection, up by 4 places. We have very stringent rules to protect the rights of IP owners. According to the Global Innovative Index 2024 announced by WIPO, we ranked the first among in terms of IP. So that means we are on a par with global standards, and we fully meet the requirements laid down by WIPO. There are different procedures at the pre- and post-registration stage to protect IP owners against abuse. We also have training. In the form of a training course for SMEs to learn about protecting their IP rights, we also have a free advisory service. We provide one-on-one sessions for SMEs to tell us about the problems they face on IP issues, and we will continue to ramp up our efforts in knowing more about IP and using IP.
The question about liquor duty is not answered yet. Well, the Secretary already responded to the question about liquor duty rate. Do you have anything else to add? The regarding arrangements have already taken into account different needs as well as the public health needs. So we will implement the arrangements as announced. Well, Chairman, I'd like to ask about trademark registration. There's an abuse of the mechanism to sue many companies in Hong Kong. There's a growing trend. So Mr. David Wong, probably we can discuss this after the meeting. Thank you. Next, Dr. Wendy Hong, I have two questions. One for Mr. Algernon Yao. I agree with developing the multinational supply chain center. We need to cement its function. But supply chain management involves logistics, finance, supply, different sectors. It goes beyond the purview of the CEDB. In some cases, trading retail I received a case from an enterprise, it's a logistics company. It wants to expand its supply chain business. It has orders providing hundreds of millions of USD per year. But in storage facilities, because of limitations of land leases, the company fails to obtain the license. It goes beyond the purview of the CEDB. I am seeking assistance from the Development Bureau. Well, Secretary, is there any way to remove the restriction? My next question is for Professor Sun. Three new schemes. One, there's the INT Industry Oriented Fund, $10 billion, and the INT Venture Fund, $1.5 billion, and the Startup Accelerator Programs. We are using different models to cover different clusters and sectors. I agree with that. But to enterprises, it's quite difficult to have a full grasp of the overall situation. I'd like to ask the Secretary the positioning of the three funds mentioned in the policy address, which is for investment, Some is for investment in high-tech projects at an early stage. Some are not, which are fund of funds, which are sub-funds, which is for local investment, which is for overseas investment. These are my questions, Professor Sun. Thank you, Dr. Wendy Hong. We have the INT industry-oriented fund, $10 billion. And the INT Venture Fund. The next one is the Startup Accelerator. That is the pilot INT Accelerator scheme. It supports startups with great results. As I mentioned, the $10 billion is a scheme that promotes INT development in Hong Kong. We cover startups, we cover leading enterprises as well. Regarding the INT Venture Fund, from the seed stage to Series B funding round, the investment scale is smaller. Enterprises can consider approaching fund managers. The third pilot INT accelerator scheme, each project $30 million max. It will lead good startups to Hong Kong. Regarding supply chain management, Mr. Arjuna Yao, thank you, Dr. Wendy Hong, for your question. For multinational supply chain work, we have been conducting work all along, but we're carrying it out in a more systematic manner. We're working with the IPD to turn it into a system that is for the better grasp by different users. Dr. Wendy Hong is right. This straddles a lot of different bureaus, supply chain management, finance, legal, construction, many different aspects. Invest Hong Kong reports to the CEDB, but it also serves different bureaus. If a company wants to go global through the help of Hong Kong, they will reflect the relevant matters to different bureaus. The Hong Kong TDC and Invest Hong Kong will work together to disseminate information to enterprises that seek to establish presence in Hong Kong, especially the enterprises from mainland China. So it won't be the case that enterprises coming to Hong Kong won't have access to sufficient information. Invest Hong Kong will continue to work hard to lead these world international enterprises to Hong Kong and help them go global. Mr. Duncan Chiu, thank you, Chairman. This is the third policy address of the Chief Executive of this term. For example, we are implementing the mission given by the country, such as the 8 center positioning. We also need to draw for talents and improve livelihood in Hong Kong. I'd like to know any concrete measures to better help the development of SMEs in Hong Kong. They are in dire straits, as they say. In Inno Hong Kong, there are two platforms. We have some 2,500 INT researchers. In building the third Inno Hong Kong platform, the government, how many more R&T talents will the government recruit? What will be other areas of the third INT platform so that members of the public will also feel the benefit of the platform. The Interdepartmental E-commerce Development Task Force will promote e-commerce. What is the progress of the work on the task force? Will there be more measures to help e-commerce businesses to reduce their expenditure on taxation? And how can we provide more land when it comes to storage facilities for the development of the industry? What will the government do? Hong Kong has a cooperation mechanism with different places in mainland China. Will there be more new schemes, or what will be the highlights so that members of the public will feel a sense of gain, or they will feel that they can benefit from the development of the industry? Professor Sun, thank you, Mr. Dennis Leung, for your question. Regarding Inno Hong Kong, the platform, I'd like to invite my colleague to give you more information. As Mr. Leung mentioned, we have set up two platforms, one on healthcare technology, the other on robotics and AI. There are subsidies for these R&D centers. They engage in different R&D personnel. So as Mr. Dennis Leung mentioned, the 29 R&D centers, we have a total of 2,500 personnel working therein. Most of them are locals. We also recruited from mainland China and the international community. We are preparing for the commissioning of the third platform. It will focus on energy, sustainable development, as well as advanced manufacturing materials and so on. Some 100 to 200 R&D personnel. So I believe the third platform will attract R&D personnel to undertake research in the respective areas. As for the existing platforms that have been up and running for 3 to 4 years, are there any results that the public can see? Let me give you a few examples. One of the R&D centers is led by the Hong Kong UST. We also have overseas partners. It came up with an early diagnosis of dementia. The other research is headed by CUHK. It's about probiotics. The hospital authority has been piloting the results of the research, so we are starting to see the commercialization of R&D outcome. Let me give you one more example. This is an important area. The large language model has been piloted in the government. We want to expand the pilot scheme and expand it to the full application in the government. Mr. Aljunan Yao, regarding e-commerce, yes, indeed, we have an interdepartmental e-commerce development task force. In August, we held a festival attracting over 90 million footfall on the internet, attracting 230 brands into the mainland market, and this is just the first step. The Hong Kong TDC will continue to organize this festival in mainland China, and we will also promote e-commerce to South Asian regions, where we'll continue to organize this event. Under BUD Fund, the cap is $7 million. $1 million is dedicated to the promotion and development of e-commerce. Overall, we are taking forward e-commerce step by step. Right now, we're focused on the taxation measures and the development of e-commerce in mainland China. Next step, will further promote e-commerce to other regions. For details, I will ask Deputy Secretary Ms. Lau to give you more information about e-commerce. Regarding regional collaboration, I will ask Ms. Maggie Wong to give you more information. Deputy Secretary Ms. Candy Lau. Thank you, Chairman.
剛才局長都講,
as the Secretary just mentioned, on e-commerce, we are making a start with the mainland market, but as for our next step, we'll look at the ASEAN market. We will address the pain points facing SMEs and we'll step up support for them. The member mentioned logistics. In 2025, we will review the cross-boundary logistics arrangements so as to enhance the efficiency for cross-boundary e-commerce goods, so as to enhance our capability. Maggie, on regional cooperation, we strive to sign free trade agreements or investment agreements with other places. Now, the second largest trading partner is the 10 ASEAN countries. Apart from signing investment agreements and free trade agreements, we've also included something special in the agreement. And that is, we've set up a working group on economic and technological cooperation. We provide assistance to different ASEAN countries in areas that Hong Kong enjoys an advantage, such as accounting, IP, e-commerce, customs clearance. And there will also be a direct liaison between the sector in Hong Kong and that in those countries. So that means apart from the G2G liaison, we also have liaison at different levels. About mainland cooperation mechanism, this is an important tool for us to integrate into our country's development. We've set up cooperation mechanisms with different provinces and cities such as Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou, Guangdong, Pan Pearl River Delta, so on and so forth. These are well-established cooperation mechanisms. The SAR government will continue to explore other mechanisms to be set up with provinces and cities with potential to step up cooperation. For example, we have the Beijing-Tianjin, as well as the Yangtze River Delta region. These are the highlights which we'll focus on. Now, in a spirit of complementarity, we will cooperate on different matters such as INT, finance, youth development, and we'll continue to expand cooperation to achieve mutual benefits. Mr. Duncan Chiu, two suggestions and one comment about helping INT enterprises along Belt and Road to go global. I see great potential in this regard. Well, we held an INT expo. Myself and Professor William Wong, we understand that there is a huge demand. I fully agree with the paper. We can't just be the super connector and super value adder. We need to help them set up presence. First and foremost, we need to help them understand the Hong Kong standards and tweak their production lines. We need to make sure that they abide by international standards before helping them go global. And that involves different government departments. We've seen some successful examples. And how do we leverage that? because in following government policies and Hong Kong standards, different government departments may be involved. How do we help them grasp the opportunities as they go global? So that's my question on Belt and Road and the Go Global strategy. Next, about the ISRE 2.0 incentive scheme for recurrent exhibition. We've seen a positive response and a support the 2.0 version of the scheme. According to the paper, the government will explore the possibility of using other exhibition venues apart from CEC and Asia World Expo. I don't know whether this includes the Kaitek Sports Park and other places such as the Central Harbourfront, Wan Chai Harbourfront, and Sky City, owned by the government but operated by a private party. My next point is about the new industry-oriented fund. I thank the government for taking on board my suggestion. I've been involved in the running of the fund for 2 years, and now there is a closer collaboration among the government, industry, INT, R&D, and academia and investors. It's very important to attract private investment. Now, the Secretary explained about the patient capital and the 6+6 investment period. All these are very good suggestions. I just want to make sure that the fund is market-oriented. For example, in terms of management fee, of course, managers will need to charge a fee. But can we do more than just basing the fees on the money invested? So that's one suggestion for you. Professor Sun, I thank Mr. Chiu for his questions. I'll answer the first and the third questions. The first is about helping enterprises go global. We've been working with Invest Hong Kong and the ETOs, and we have stepped up the extent of investment, and we have attracted some quality investments. The focus is on super connector and super value adder. For these enterprises to go global, they need to first find a footing in Hong Kong. They will make use of the advantages in Hong Kong and add value to themselves. Let me give you one example. There is an R&D company in Beijing. When it comes to Hong Kong, it blooms. So carrying the Beijing gene, they leverage on the system in Hong Kong. Finally, they go global. According to their experience, they find merits in the systems in Hong Kong, in writing proposals, in seeking funding. They have learned a lot, and when they tap the market in Singapore, they're able to mirror Hong Kong's model. So that's one example. We need to fulfill our roles as a super connector and a super value adder. About the fund of funds under the INT industry oriented fund, your comment is noted. For management fees, when we conduct a market sounding exercise, we will be tapping the views of the market. All in all, we need to make sure that the fund is market-oriented. We need to find the common ways and standards adopted by the market in making the fund right. About exhibitions, Secretary, I thank Member for his support for the incentive scheme for recurrent exhibitions. The purpose is to attract more large-scale exhibitions to be held regularly in Hong Kong. As set out in the policy address, we need to consider some practical requirements. I will give the floor to Deputy Secretary Ms. Grace Kok to give you more details. Thank you, Member, for the question. As the Secretary mentioned, the ISRE 2.0 has made reference to some successful exhibitions under the original scheme. And in this 2.0 version, we will further discuss with the sector some implementation details. For example, in terms of eligible venues, can we widen the scope? Now, this is something that we will further discuss with the stakeholders, and we'll definitely consider their views. Thank you, Grace. Next, Mr. Edmund Wong. Thank you, Chairman. Now, when the administration answered members' questions, they on a number of occasions referred to accounting. So the government attaches importance to the accountancy sector. It is also crucial to attracting inward investment, and whether investment is made to the real economy so as to drive the growth of different industries, including professional services. First of all, I acknowledge the work of the government in the past few years. As mentioned in the paper, from January 2023 to September 2024, Invest Hong Kong has assisted 852 enterprises to set up their presence in Hong Kong or expand the business in Hong Kong. Now, in the first 9 months of this year, they've quickened their pace. In fact, the Invest Hong Kong has assisted 470 such enterprises, far exceeding the target or the number recorded last year. But I want to know whether targets in terms of the number of jobs to be created here and the amount of investment made, because it's not clear just by looking at the number of enterprises setting up their presence in Hong Kong. I want to know whether these enterprises help drive economic development and create jobs. Last month, the US Congress passed a resolution, and that is about the Hong Kong ETO recognition or accreditation bill, and that the ETOs in the US may close as a result. Now, according to the government, there will not be a significant impact even in the event of the closure of the Hong Kong ETOs in the United States. If the impact is not significant, I can't help but doubt why we are spending so much money to keep these ETOs running every year. Why are we continuing to expand the ETO network if they are not significant? Invest Hong Kong and the consultant offices are proactive in expanding the network. The third consultant office will be set up in Turkey, as I understand. So what is the government's take on the future of Hong Kong ETOs? Don't just cite numbers. I want to make sure that our money is well spent. I'd like the government to give a response. Well, I wouldn't say that our ETOs will cease their operation. I think they are forced to do so. Secretary, Invest Hong Kong has made a lot of efforts. As set out in the paper, we attracted a lot of enterprises to come from 2023 to 2024. We've attracted 850 plus enterprises to set up their business in Hong Kong. And so far this year, we have attracted 470 enterprises to come to Hong Kong. Now, let me give you more figures. 6,173 jobs are created by the 470 enterprises with a direct investment amount of $47.8 billion. Invest Hong Kong will continue to strive to achieve the KPIs and attract as many enterprises to come to Hong Kong as possible. According to the KPI, the annual target is 1,130, and they have exceeded that number. The member also referred to the ETOs. There are three ETOs in the United States. The bill has been passed by the US Congress to cancel the or withdraw the exemptions for the Hong Kong ETOs in the United States, and that these ETOs may close. According to the chief secretary, even if our ETOs are forced to cease operation, we will continue to expand our trade network. I don't think he's suggesting that the ETOs are not significant. So I think this is a misconception. Even after the ETOs have been closed, we'll continue to explore means to expand our network. Indeed, we set up ETOs and offices in different places. Because of geopolitics, we need to find partners in new economies apart from the Western countries. Now, the chief executive has led the delegation to visit the Middle East, and this is a great opportunity for us. We are looking at different markets in the Middle East, Central Asia, as well as Eastern Europe. And that is why an ETO will be set up in Saudi Arabia and another ETO will be set up in Malaysia. Consultant offices under the Invest Hong Kong will be set up in various places as well, because we want to reach out to different economies to achieve mutual benefit. We have 66 offices covering 129 economies. So it is the government's objective to tap new economies when it comes to expansion of the ETO network.
Thank you, Mr. Shang Hailong. First of all, I have to commend the administration for showing concern about the INT sector. Despite the financial position of the government, there are still some measures regarding INT, for example, funds of funds, measures supporting the development of AI, and so on. My questions focus on INT. We have seen quite great results about the development of INT. Totaling 53 companies which have obtained subsidies. Regarding Race Plus and Inner Hong Kong, from the perspective of economic benefits, the investments are not quite worth the investment. So I'd like to ask the administration about figures. Talents are important. To enlarge the INT talent pool to create strong impetus for growth, I didn't see the points about the grooming of talents. The third phase of Inner Hong Kong project in 2023 or earlier, we have already put in place some measures. That is the Research Talent Hub. What about the KPI? Do we have any targets in relation to the enlargement of the INT talent pool? Any target? The first question. Well, as announced, Inner Hong Kong is not covered by the investments made by the Hong Kong IC. Race Plus just approved the first batch of companies. I should put it this way. In the past few years, Inner Hong Kong has subsidize some companies. After all, it's a business decision when it comes to investments. I cannot give you a definite answer right here, but I believe there will be more and more Hong Kong investment channels, including Hong Kong IC or Innovation and Technology Fund. Regarding enlarging the INT talent pool, I'd like to ask Mr. Lee to give you more information regarding how we can enlarge the INT talent pool. As Mr. Shang mentioned, In Hong Kong is one of the platforms in Hong Kong. There are quite many R&T personnel working here. We also have a scheme to subsidize private enterprises to engage R&D personnel to undertake R&D work. We also have an INT internship scheme in summer holidays for students studying the INT subjects. We arrange for them to work in private companies to work on the promotion of INT, that is the STEM internship scheme. The policy address supplement mentions some of the work indicators. For example, under the Research Talent Hub, 10,050 in 2022 was increased to 18,500 in 2027. Regarding STEM internship scheme, it is hoped that the figures will increase from 300 to over 5,000 in 2027. Next, Dr. Johnny Ng. Thank you, Chairman. First of all, I support the policy address. The government has done much on promoting the local economy. The CEDB and the Hong Kong TDC has done a lot on helping local companies to go global. We also attract a lot of inward investments to come to Hong Kong. This is worth our commendation. I have two questions for the CMAB and the ITIB. The third plenum mentioned that we need to carry out and deepen our reform. That is to promote the culture of the two places and to reform the development of the two places. Earlier on, we ceased operation of the ETOs in Taiwan. So in order to implement the spirit of the third plenum, how can we support our development in Taiwan, including cultural exchanges as well as economic development? Regarding National Data Bureau, 2 weeks ago, they issued a new paper on promoting digital China and digital infrastructures. 2 weeks ago, I went to mainland China on a study trip. I visited Data Exchange Center and its development. 46 have been commissioned. There are also standardization projects. We have Digital Policy Office in Hong Kong. So how will it tie in with the work on the mainland China? Mr. Algernon Yao. Thank you, Chairman. Well, I'll give the floor to the CMAB. Yes. Maybe Mr. Eric Zhang first. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Dr. Johnny Ng, for your question regarding our ties with mainland China. In 2021, the Taiwan side repeatedly intervened in Hong Kong matters. There were also anti-China remarks. It affected our ties with Taiwan. The ETO in Taiwan was also affected. The personnel working therein was threatened in relation to their personal safety. That's exactly why we ceased operation of the ETO in Taiwan earlier on. The interchanges and interactions have not been affected. When Hong Kong people require assistance in Taiwan, there's a mechanism in place. Through communication, we can render assistance to Hong Kong people in Taiwan. We can provide appropriate assistance to them. We will have regard to the situation in Taiwan before we map out our future direction. Then we'll decide what our next step will be. I'll draw a line here. After Mr. Michael Tan speaks, I will ask the last question. Mr. Michael Tan, please. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to speak to the Secretary for CED. I declared that I work in the retail sector. 5 months a year, the net value saw a double-digit drop. It's very serious. We never saw it before. I'm not optimistic about the future. It's a structural change. In Hong Kong, wages are high, so are rents as well as general prices. Hong Kong people go north to spend. We have visitors coming south. I don't see any short-term solution to buck the trend. The retail sector employs 500,000 to 600,000 in Hong Kong, accounting for a large proportion of the labor force in Hong Kong. We have Hong Kong vehicles going north. And we can even drive to Zhongshan. But I'm not sure if you know how serious the situation right now is. Let me show you something. Well, Mr. Michael Tan, can you ask your questions directly? It's not an introductory session. Well, I have to let the secretary know the dire straits we're in. From 2005 to 2024, over a period of about two decades, retail value was $250 billion. Even worse than the figure in 2011, that is $260 billion. At that time, $126 per square foot. Right now, it's $171 per feet. The median income increased by some 88%, from 8,500 to 16,000. We need to bring down rents. We cannot reduce wages. We need to wait for two years before rents will see a downward trend again. It will drop by 30 to 40%. I am confident about it. Providing a 24-month loan to SMEs, the principal principal moratorium scheme. So will you consider the rates? Can you discuss internally for the coming 24 months? Can you exempt the rates of all shops? Rates account for some 5% of the rents. We need to bring it down by 3% in order to help companies or SMEs to stay afloat. It's very important to help them stay afloat in the coming 2 years, where rates are not within the terms of reference of this panel, so you do not have to respond to this. What about the remaining questions? Thank you, Mr. Michael Tan, for providing us with this figure. We also have the relevant figures, and we know the retail sector situation very well. Yes, indeed, there's a shift in consumption patterns, and we need to help SMEs to stay afloat. We have put in place a series of measures, say the principal moratorium scheme, the export credit insurance scheme. HKMA and banks also roll out 5 measures. An amount of $370 billion is set aside to help SMEs or other companies to stay afloat. We will discuss internally to see how we can better help SMEs. Thank you, Mr. Michael Tin. It's about time to wrap up. I'll first extend the meeting by 15 minutes. Next, Mr. Ma Fong Kwok. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you for letting me ask questions. I have two questions. One, to better grasp the high-quality development and the dual circulation of the country and the business opportunities arising therefrom. That is paragraph 29. We understand dual circulation is a very important target. When it comes to internal circulation, we need to expand domestic demand. There are five paragraphs in this regard. However, when it comes to expanding domestic circulation, there are many geopolitical matters and measures rolled out by overseas countries to limit our development. So what measures does the administration have in order to help our local development in relation to digital China on building a smart Hong Kong? The Secretary mentioned some measures. I'd like to know how Hong Kong can tie in with the national strategy of building digital China. What measures do you have in concrete terms? Thank you.
Professor Sun Dong, please. I thank Mr. Ma Fong Kwok for his questions. In order to expedite the development of a digital government and improve our cybersecurity measures, on the 25th of July this year, under the ITIB, the government established the Digital Policy Office, led by Mr. Tony Wong as the commissioner. The Digital Policy Office is in charge of a number of areas. I will give the floor to Mr. Tony Wong to explain that. Is it coming through? Thank you for the questions. Digital China is a development strategy on a macro level. The government will take a two-pronged approach. First, digital government in Hong Kong. We're going to go digital for the government services. We also roll out measures in relation to promoting digital infrastructure. For example, we're going to proceed to phase one of AI supercomputing center at Cyberport. We'll also build infrastructure for AI technology, which can help enterprises in terms of big data analytics and the use of AI. For the national strategy, let me give you some examples. We have a three-year action plan with the Greater Bay Area in relation to a single portal for government services in the Greater Bay Area. We'll also facilitate the flow of data across GBA cities. This facilitation measure can help promote digital development in different cities in the Greater Bay Area and promote economic development. And we are also acting with the Shanghai government on building a data hub. And we also have a competition on opening up of data. We are going to sign a cooperation agreement with Shanghai to further facilitate synergistic development between the two places. This can help our enterprises tap their market and help Shanghai enterprises go global. But I also have some questions, but my question hasn't been answered about the dual circulation strategy. The CDB is concerned about the dual circulation strategy, especially the international circulation. This is the work of Invest Hong Kong in attracting enterprises to tap the GBA as well as mainland markets. Now, we've taken part in some collaboration initiatives, especially those within the Greater Bay Area. We also signed investment agreements and free trade agreements with other places so as to attract more enterprises to come to Hong Kong. In fact, on external circulation, we just signed a new agreement under SEPA that is about trade in services. We also continue to seek accession to RCEP so as to find more opportunities to Hong Kong and attract more enterprises to set a presence in Hong Kong. I will now invite the Director General of to elaborate on this answer. For SEPA, in early this month, we amended the agreement under SEPA for the second time in response to the industry's requests. For areas that Hong Kong enjoys advantages, we have opened up further the liberalization measures. For example, we've relaxed the requirement for the services industry to tap the mainland market, and they've also scrapped the requirement for Hong Kong enterprises to have substantive business operations in Hong Kong, in the mainland for at least 3 years in most service sectors. Now, we have some new initiatives such as allowing Hong Kong investor enterprises to adopt Hong Kong laws and choose Hong Kong as a seat of arbitration. That means for enterprises recently tapping the GBA market, they will be able to adopt Hong Kong law, so use Hong Kong and Macau as the seat of arbitration. These are some of the trade facilitation measures. I want to ask a couple of questions as well. But first of all, let me express my views on behalf of my sector. We highly commend the work of the Chief Executive in the latest policy address. There are a lot of measures that will bring economic benefits to Hong Kong. There are also measures to support SMEs, such as the principal moratorium arrangement. It will be reintroduced, and the period will be extended to 12 months. This is a very useful arrangement. The previous pre-approved principal payment holiday scheme tied many SMEs over during the toughest times. But after that, we also need to be self-reliant. There is this Arabic saying called intrala. We can't hold hostage to fortune. We cannot just rely on the divine. We must also be proactive in tapping new opportunities. So I support the new initiatives in the policy address. For example, the CDB will help enterprises go global. And this is what Secretary just now said, the external circulation. And the maximum indemnity ratio of the Hong Kong's Export Credit Insurance Corporation will go up from 90 to 95%. I think that this is a positive response to the market's demand, and this will bolster our confidence. For liquor duty, for years, we've advocated the total withdrawal of the duty. The response has been positive so far, but I hope that the government will make a bolder move following the successful example of the wine duty, we've been able to make Hong Kong a major wine auction center. In terms of logistics, transportation, insurance, and warehousing, there have been positive developments after the wine duty was scrapped in 2008. The government should be bold. You should reduce the liquor duty to zero. I'd like to follow up on some questions raised by members. If possible, would the administration please respond to these points? It's very important to promote Hong Kong to the world. Mr. Ambrose Lam asked about the good deeds of the government, including automatic extension of leases for 50 years. But this is not extensively publicized, not to the foreigners or locals. Since there will be a lot of new developments in Hong Kong, including the Hong Kong Park in the Loop, we need the SAR government and the TDC to do more. In fact, I've often cited the TDC. I know that the TDC has been making a lot of efforts in terms of promoting Hong Kong to the five continents. So tell us more about your good work. As for the mainland, we need to foster closer collaboration under the dual circulation strategy. So this is a question for the three secretaries. Would you like to respond to these points, Mr. Yao? Well, I thank members for their questions, and I thank Chairman for his comments. On telling good stories of Hong Kong, like the Chairman said, the SAR government has made a lot of efforts. It all boils down to adopting a good strategy to tell the world about Hong Kong. Now, the Invest Hong Kong, TDC, and the Belt and Road Office are all responsible, because it's one way of telling good stories of Hong Kong. The annual Belt and Road Summit marks a very important occasion for us to tell about the opportunities in Hong Kong to the Belt and Road countries. Now, as mentioned at today's meeting, the representatives of ETOs will be coming back to Hong Kong next month to report their work progress, and will remind them to tell good stories of Hong Kong, not just about the work of the CEDB. The ETOs in different jurisdictions serve the whole of the SAR government. So the ETOs are responsible for relaying the Hong Kong SAR's government's message to their respective jurisdictions. They will publicize our advantages, our opportunities. So definitely, the ETOs will help promote the positive image of Hong Kong to the world. Now, I represent the business sector. As far as I know, many people around the world are interested in INT development in Hong Kong. Some INT companies in the world are interested in our potential in INT development here. So I believe this is the achievement of the respective parties' promotion efforts. So under your leadership, Professor Sun Dong, I hope that we could scale new heights on INT development. Do you have anything to say in response? Thank you. Thank you, Chairman, for your comments. Hong Kong has entered the golden era of INT development. These development opportunities are hard to come by. We have research capability. We also have the talents ready. We have won global competitions and awards. As for the next step, we need to build a talent hub, I mean an international hub for high caliber talent. We need to leverage on our advantages in building Hong Kong into an international INT center, because INT is more than just global ranking. We need to take forward high quality development, and INT development is the core element. In the policy address, we ride on the initiatives rolled out in the previous two governments, and there are also new initiatives. You see consistency in the three terms of government. We have the Race Plus One scheme, and then we also have the $10 billion new industrialization funding scheme. And this year, another $10 billion have been set aside for the new industry-oriented fund. So we've mapped out our development direction very clearly. I hope that a joint effort can be made to support INT development in Hong Kong so as to develop new quality productive forces. We will also mount publicity and tell good stories of INT development in Hong Kong so that we can pull together INT resources from around the world.
Thank you, Secretary. We have been working very closely with the mainland China. Could you please also supplement? Thank you, Chairman. As we are integrating into the overall development of the country, we are having closer and closer ties with the mainland China. In addition to attracting enterprises and investments, as well as supporting Hong Kong people's life in mainland China, we have been scrambling for high quality enterprises and high caliber talents to come to Hong Kong so that they can put down roots in Hong Kong. This can also facilitate interfacing with mainland China. This is what we are doing at full steam. We also tell good stories of Hong Kong in mainland China. In my introductory remarks, I already said that we use a lot of different methods to enhance liaison with mainland China. We delivered speeches, there were media interviews, we took part in different events, both online and offline, in order to promote the traditional advantages of Hong Kong. There were also duty visits. Say, this March we went to Toronto, Canada. In May we went to Paris. We went to California. In August we went to Seoul, Korea. And we're going to visit Australia and Malaysia towards the end of this year as well. Together with the ITIB and Invest Hong Kong, we will conduct duty visits to tell the good stories of Hong Kong, to tell them the great opportunities of the GBA, so that we can step up publicity on this front. We'll continue to enhance our work in this area. We'll tell the mainland China about our important role as a super connector and super value adder. Regarding foreign capital, foreign brands and enterprises, so they can use Hong Kong as a platform to go global, we'll continue to enhance our work on this front. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, three secretaries. I definitely believe in the coming few months, we can see a lot of fruits in Hong Kong, especially in West Hong Kong. We're waiting for fruits to come. I believe the measures will come to fruition soon. All the conditions are right. We have good policies. We should sing our own praises. Hong Kong is indeed a good place. So we will definitely see good development of Hong Kong. I thank officials for coming to the meeting today. Next agenda item, AOB. Any other business? No. Meeting adjourned. Thank you, members.